Good evening, everybody. James Hancock here, back to review episode 3 of Sharp Objects, an episode called Fix. But before I get to my official recap and review, I just want to give one quick warning. A couple days ago, I was digging through the internet just looking for news related to the show about Sharp Objects, whether or not it's doing well for HBO, and what future plans there might be for more shows based on the work of Gillian Flynn. And I accidentally stumbled upon some pretty colossal spoilers that come from the book. Admittedly, I don't know how rigidly the show is going to adhere to the book, but because Gillian Flynn is involved, I imagine it'll more or less be as written. But there's good news and there's bad news. The bad news is, two of the biggest spoilers imaginable, I accidentally blundered into. But the good news is, there's some really dark, eerie, creepy, cool shit coming our way in the episodes to come. I feel like this show has been teasing it for a couple of episodes, and there's definitely this dark sense of menace that's been building and growing, and I feel like tonight's episode really hinted at a lot of that. But the reason I bring this up is just to forewarn people so they don't accidentally stumble upon this information, but also just to reassure people, if you're wavering in your interest in the show, and I know some people, and I know the show is not necessarily for everybody. I've been reading the comments the last two episodes, and some people think that it's a little slow. I do not agree with that view, but to those people, I would just say, be patient. The show is absolutely going to deliver some really dark, horrific stuff. But I thought tonight's episode was pretty damn good, and maybe it was because it reminded me a lot of some of my own experiences in high school, where this episode really captured the nightlife of what goes down in a small town where there's not a lot going on. I didn't spend my high school years in a town as small as Wind Gap, but it was definitely a quiet city with very little nightlife. And most of the nightlife for high school kids just consisted of a lot of driving around looking for a place where you wouldn't be harassed by parents and or cops. And this is also in the era before cell phones, so it's just really hard and confusing to find people and so on and so forth. But there was a certain element of danger and mystery to those evenings, and I feel like this episode captured that really well. In any case, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. This episode really focuses intensely on two major relationships in Camille's life, the first of which is her relationship with her roommate Alice when she was in rehab. Both Alice and Camille were in this rehab center for people who have a tendency to do harm to themselves physically. And it's there that we see that Camille develops her love of music. Prior to being roommates with Alice, she's kind of indifferent to music, but like the 5 minutes a day that Alice feels like she's actually getting to escape from this place is when she puts on her headphones and listens to Led Zeppelin. And she then passes on that love to Camille. And there's some really interesting, eerie bonding sessions where they're talking about the scars and bruises on their legs and whether or not they can wear mini skirts. At one point, we get a glimpse of Camille's left hip, and it's just a network of words and scars. It was some deeply unsettling stuff in a lot of ways. But I don't feel like any of this material is being used for the purposes of exploitation. Not that I mind exploitation films, but I feel like this show does tackle these issues with a certain amount of sensitivity. And just the fact that the show makes such a deliberate effort at the end to encourage people to seek help who have these tendencies, I feel like this show's heart is in the right place on that front. But I've always been a big sucker for story construction, story structure. I'm absolutely fascinated by that element of storytelling. And I like how all these scenes in the rehab clinic are used as flashbacks scattered throughout the episode. And it really acts as a major exclamation mark toward the end of the episode. Camille discovers that her roommate has chugged a bottle of Clorox in order to kill herself. It's a really gruesome graphic scene. And what it immediately prompts Camille to do in order to express her own grief, first she runs into the bathroom to throw up, but then she sees that there's a screw on the back of the toilet. She unscrews it and just proceeds to start hacking away her form. It's definitely the most overtly disgusting violent stuff we've seen in the show so far. I mean, obviously, seeing a corpse without any teeth is very disturbing, but watching Camille just rip into your arm, that completely caught me off guard. I basically like leaped back from the TV. I found it so shocking. But the other main storyline this episode was the growing intimacy, but also the growing tension between Camille and Amma. While most of the town is still embroiled in this debate about whether or not it was a drifter or a possible trucker who may have killed these girls, there are a lot of people like Willis who believe that the killer must be somebody who knew the girls. That 9 in 10 cases when somebody's murdered is by someone that they know, and this is obviously a very small town. And as Camille is trying to interview people and trying to gather information, once again we see Adora trying to stop her, trying to block her every way that she possibly can. Adora is clearly racked with unresolved feelings toward Camille. At one point, they're having a debate or an argument while Adora's doing some gardening. She cuts herself on a rose and immediately looks at her daughter and blames the cut on her. And whenever I see someone behaving that way in a story, it always makes me feel like she's overcompensating for something that's deep and dark and secret in her past. And my spider sense really started tingling when she was trying so hard to warn Amma about how dangerous Camille might be. Adora's starting to get a little hint that Amma is growing up because Amma's now getting caught breaking curfew. She even catches her wearing some different wardrobe when Amma very quickly makes up a lie that she was playing dress up with her friends. But when Amma and Camille are bonding over what qualified as being wild back in Camille's day, she said basically she hung out in parking lots and talked to boys. It wasn't anything too outrageous. Where you get the sense that Amma is really ready for some pretty aggressive socializing, some pretty aggressive partying. I mean, even during the day when things are pretty innocent, she's blasting around town on her roller skates. The show actually makes you want to buy a pair of skates and go ripping around New York City. But my favorite scene of the episode is at night. Amma invites Camille out to go partying. Camille turns her down, but Camille ends up at a bar hanging out with Wills. They get wasted and they decide to go explore the town so Camille can tell them about some of her experiences growing up. And they're getting wasted in one of her old hangout spots where all the teenagers used to do heavy petting, as she describes. And who should arrive but Amma and her friends. And I have to say, seeing Amma and her friends at night when they're looking for some action, they remind me like of one of the gangs in the Walter Hill film, The Warriors, from the late 70s. They look so cool, and they're very clearly looking to provoke people, talk some shit, get some action going. First, they just roll up to him, make fun of Willis and Camille, saying, I go, Camille and Willis sitting in a tree, F-U-C-K-I-N-G, you know, little girl stuff. But then Amma really gets in her sister's face and says right in front of Willis, if you were to murder me right here and now, Willis still wouldn't be able to figure it out. Obviously, Amma's very deliberately trying to provoke a response, and there's even like a little bit of pushing and kind of like a physical confrontation before the girls go hauling ass off to go talk to some boys. And I don't know why this scene had such a big impact on me. I think it gave me this really intense flashback from like 25 years ago. Hanging out in parking lots, hanging on the side of the road. A lot of my high school experiences were behind this movie theater that was next door to McDonald's. For whatever reason, this one McDonald's and movie theater, due to their proximity, just became this giant high school hangout. But there was just this intense, eerie authenticity to the atmosphere of the scenes that I really responded to. But in response, Camille hops in her car. She goes hauling ass down the road. She's driving towards St. Louis. She's getting up to about 90 miles an hour, and she's totally wasted. She should not be driving at all, much less like 90 miles an hour. And what does she end up seeing in front of her? She sees that white apparition, that lady in white, as part of the local urban folklore and possibly a suspect in these murders. For me, it worked as a genuine jump scare. It definitely caught me off guard. I got some serious heebie-jeebies. And Camille immediately slams on the brakes, and she's so disturbed by the incident, she throws away the iPod that has all the songs that she and Lisa used to listen to together. Hopefully that does not mean an end to all the great music in this show, but the teaser suggested some really cool stuff that's coming up in the next episode. We see that it's really gonna dig into a specific incident during Camille's upbringing in this cabin out in the woods. It looks like it might get pretty ugly in the next episode. In any event, I'm still absolutely totally hooked on this show. There are very few shows that I mark on my calendar where I basically make it a priority where everything else is secondary. But right now, while I'm waiting for some shows to come back, like Better Call Saul and some other shows like that, Sharp Objects is the only show that I watch then and there at the time where it comes out. And I'm thrilled to see that this show is developing a small but passionate and very vocal following. But if you enjoyed my recap and review, or if you just want to talk more about the episode, you can definitely hunt me down on Twitter at Colbrax. If you would consider subscribing to my channel, I would be your best friend for life. I would really appreciate it. And coming up this week, I'm definitely going to be reviewing the first episode of Castle Rock on Hulu. That looks absolutely amazing. I'm a Stephen King fanatic. If you look up in this corner, it's nothing but Stephen King novels from the 70s through the early 90s. That period I really enjoy, and it looks like Castle Rock is really going to explore that really intensely. And also, I'm going to be reviewing the new Mission Impossible movie on Thursday, so I hope you'll come back for both those videos. But I think that's about all I have to say about tonight's episode, so thank you so much for watching my channel. I really appreciate it. Onwards and upwards.